You can call it wild, you can call it crazy, you can call it outright, downright outrageous, but you can't call it boring. It's dynamic, dazzling, and certainly sizzling Supercross racing that can be found only on Moto Video. It's your front row seat to the hottest motorsports events in the nation, and it's all on home video cassette. So sit back, put on your gloves, strap on your helmet, pop it into gear, and prepare yourself for Supercross racing action from Moto Video.
To the world-famous Rose Bowl in Pasadena, California. We're about to see the Fram Autolite 1985 Rose Bowl 125 Supercross Championships. A very pleasant good evening to you. I'm Steve Grad with Danny Laporte. Welcome to our telecast. This is the last 125 championship race of the year, and it's oh so very important to these youngsters who most of them are between 16 and 20 years old.
That's right, and it means a lot to them. They're here tonight. They get a lot of exposure. It's the last race of the year, and it means a lot to them as far as money and better sponsors for next year.
When they move up to the 250cc, the purses are a little bit bigger, and the sponsorships are a little bit bigger. And what these youngsters lack in experience, they make up for in heart and guts on this rugged Supercross track. A man who's on that rugged Supercross track is our Dave Stanfield. Here's his first report, Dave.
Young man and machine are going to take a beating out here. The inexperience might be a little bit of factor, but one of the big factors, the toughest Supercross track ever, possibly, and 65,000 screaming fans.
And we'll be back from the Rose Bowl with more action right after this.
Events like this one are getting hotter every day. All across the country, tranquil playing fields are being transformed into treacherous red-hot race courses, guaranteed to challenge even the best racers. This is Stadium Supercross, the newest development to jump into the world of motocross racing. The leaping technology of faster motorcycles and better riders has left the fixed backcountry track in the dust. Now, track designers can create a course that's just a little bit tougher each race. But there's more to it than just arranging dirt.
It is really a science. It's not, we just don't go down there and throw dirt together. We really have to look at the berms, the corners, and how they line up with the jumps, how big to make the jumps when you make a triple or a double jump, what we call whoop-de-doos. They've got to be made a certain way where they actually break the rider's rhythm when he goes through them.
Mike DiStefano is leading the pack of mobile motocross course creators. Previously a successful commercial photographer, Mike capped his lenses forever in favor of bumps, jumps, and whoop-de-doos.
What's nice about the whole business is it's like doing a play. I go down and I set a stage, we have the event, the fans are excited, they leave, we start a new project. You never run into the same situation. And there's a lot of good feeling from that.
Setting the stage begins about 5 days before the starter's flag will drop. A crew of 100 construction people will work 24 hours a day to arrange 6,500 cubic yards of dirt in precise piles.
We actually document after every race where the best lines on the racetrack was, size of the obstacles, the way they're positioned, etc.
Sound like an army of angry bees fills the air as the first wave of motocross riders meet at the starting bar for a wheel-to-wheel battle. The battlefield is complete, but Mike's job isn't over yet.
I make sure that things are happening, and they happen on schedule. Tell my crews who are all on headsets with me. Basically, I'm their eyes. They're down there doing the work.
8 minutes, let's get the sweepstakes down there.
All right, we'll play it by ear in the intermissions. I may give you more than 15 minutes of the ride. Did you copy announcer one?
I think it's great. It's rougher than it's ever been before. It's the best one I've seen yet.
Tough tracks work. We got to keep building them tougher.
Welcome back to the Rose Bowl. You can hear this crowd is pumped up for tonight's event. Your overall point standings for the season. Mike Healy with a 9-point lead over second place Bobby Moore. These are the top 10 riders in this 125 series class. Earlier tonight, we had the qualifying heats. And here's how our expert Danny Laporte and I called heat one.
They come out of there quickly. It's very important to come out of the pack fast. And they get over the start breaker. There's a good corner block right up on the front. As they come over the rockers on the tight curves, Danny Laporte, that's a tight curve in there.
Yeah, that's where a lot of the race is gonna be blocked right here. See where these guys are crashing? Now the top three guys are going to be hard to catch if you want to qualify.
Down the triple jump they come, and this will be the first lap. Lap number one out of six, they go down the 10-foot drop of the mountain.
Just hanging
around. Now, but these three fellas are way out in front. As you see them coming down the mountain, Danny, what's the strategy for the leaders? They can't let up.
Well, I can see right now that third place is trying to pass second, so he's not slowing down. He wants to win.
That's Brooks. Larry Brooks, the favorite. He is older than most of these kids. He's in his early 20s, and most of these 125ers are in their teens, some as young as 16 years old. Look at Brooks handle those hoop-de-doos. Eddie Hicks, a former mini bike champion, right behind him, over the double jumps. What's the change from mini bike to these 125?
From a mini bike to a 125 is like going from a 100cc to a 500cc. It's a really big difference. And it takes at least a year on a circuit like this to even get used to the bike.
David Stanfield has a bird's eye view of what's going on, Dave.
I sure do. Larry Brooks did not have the best position on his start. It's drawn out of a hat, but he went into the lead fearless. Right behind him is Eddie Hicks. Now, if you had to pick two guys that were going to win the 125 class, it's your two leaders. And Brooks just did a flying W on the back straight there. Now comes through the rockers. This guy is wide out.
And part of his ability to do those is his body control. He's constantly flowing back and forth on his bike, Danny.
Yeah, he's got, when he goes off the jump, he's got to throw his weight back and push the bike out. You can see like he just did. And on that jump over there where he almost crashed, he didn't try hard enough. He hesitated a little bit.
Larry Brooks with that commanding lead, going over the 4x4s and now over the whoop-de-doos, handling them well in this first qualifying heat. Not trying to set any kind of records, just being steady to go on to win the first heat. But there's plenty more action. The second qualifying heat. These people were also battling very hard, but battling the hardest was Billy Frank, way out in front. Billy had control around all the qualifying laps, despite some mishaps. Nobody was injured. And as they went into the later stages of the race, here's how Danny Laporte and I called it.
Meanwhile, back at the ranch, I don't see cautions out. They're still going. Frank is still going. Dunn Kentling was the man who fell off the bike. And he's trying to get it restarted. He's okay. As we watch Frank come down the 10-foot drop. We're now coming up to the last lap. They signal it with the flag. Those are the only two signals you get from that finish line, as Frank is the man in front. They just have to play it careful on that final lap, don't they,
Danny? Yes, Steve, that's right. Right now, it looks like the top three riders are slowing down quite a bit because some of the other riders are slowly catching. So they're just being really careful to finish. They're qualifying, and that's the way they want to finish.
There's a good shot of Howard is tightening up from that camera angle. And another good one as they are flying over some of those obstacles and around those very tight curves. You got to remember, there's two lines of this track which enables them to pass. and it lets the race continue. As Billy Frank comes through and wins as he finishes down the mountaintop, Campbell finished second, and Bobby Moore came in third in the second qualifying heat of the 125. And now these racers who have just qualified for the big, big finals have a few minutes to regroup, check their bikes, get them in top flight working order, go over a few things with their mechanics, and just outright rest a few minutes. Now the fans have a very important part to play because they vote for the Toyota Truck Racer of the Year. And the official winner was Jeff Ward from the 250cc class. Congratulations to Jeff for being voted this prestigious honor of Toyota Truck Racer of the Year. And we'll be back with more exciting action from the Rose Bowl right after this.
Back in time to 1975, 1979, and 1981. Moto Video is taking you back to motocross classic events. Events that stir up memories of Bell, Barnett, Hanna, Smith, Gibson, Reed, Howerton, and Hansen.
Is neck and neck. And handlebar to handlebar between Mark Barnett and Mike Bell. And look at him going. Bell takes the lead. I don't believe it. Incredible. Mike Bell has gone back in front. And Barnett is shaking his head. Now watch for the riding strategy of Mark Barnett. He will try to fake Bell out once again and pass him where he isn't expecting it. And there it is! Barnett on the inside, no, Bell comes back again! Barnett tried to sneak by on the inside like a snake oil salesman of the night. And Bell took it right, oh! And Bell is down! Bell is off the track and the crowd is screaming!
Call it a blast from the past when you get your hands on Moto Video Classics. From the Moto Video archives of videotape racing footage comes the 1975 and 1979 Super Bowl of motocross from the LA Coliseum. Tougher tracks combined with outrageous, reckless riding make these oldies motocross action you just can't pass up. And from Do It in the Dirt, Kansas City, 1981, see how Supercross has truly survived the test of time as Bell and Barnett take it out on each other in a wild and crazy Missouri track. Get into the Moto Video Classic Time Machine and experience great races of the past forever. Look for more Moto Video Classics to be released soon. All titles one low price of $29.95.
Welcome back to the Rose Bowl. Steve Brad with you. We have a break in the Supercross action. And we have a chance to show you something that took place a little earlier, a very unique event. This is quad racing. These things look like dirt cars with handlebars. That's right, four wheels, and they're gonna blast across most of this Supercross track. There they go. Today's quad racer event is brought to you by Suzuki, makers of the high-performance quad sport and quad racer. Suzuki, the foremost in four-wheeling. Some of those fellas having trouble getting over that double jump, but they're gamely going to try and battle this entire course. This is a new innovation by Suzuki. It's very stable, and this is a rough course. You know, you wouldn't want to try to go over some of these 10-foot drops on a three-wheeler. You'd definitely end up. The interesting thing about it, these guys, although some of them are former Supercross racers, most of them are average guys who just took it up. No, they're not going to go over those whoop-de-doos. You know that. There were eight qualifying races in the Los Angeles area. And you had to win one of them to qualify for tonight. There were five up in the San Francisco Bay Area. And the top three from San Francisco qualified. Then in Utah, they had the Western States Championships. And they've got three of the people from there. This thing can take more brute punishment than a two-wheeler, obviously, because it's twice as wide. And there's money being paid. For first place, you get $1,200, $800 for second, $600 for third. This is really something in these qualifyings. And the guys who made it through here get right into the finals of the quad racer. And now we've got the best of the best in the quad racer final. Most of the people in Supercross are in their late teens and early 20s. The fellas here are in their late to middle 20s. There's even a fella who's 45 years old, Mike Heiberger. He has no sponsor. He's number 33, and he's still here battling these youngsters. Ron Hassey, number 29, is also here. But then most of the leaders are your fellas in their early 20s, former Supercross stars who handle this track. And they're doing quite a job. Not easy to pass with a four-wheeler. Once you get locked in a line, it's almost a parade. The man in the front is doing a nice job at securing his lead, and that's Gary Denton, number 54. He hails from Chino, California, and Denton is a former Supercross racer. And now that he's at the ripe old age of 23, he decided it's time to graduate into something a little different, perhaps a little easier on his body, the quad racers. And he has really taken those jumps, but I'll tell you something, he's got to have strong Popeye forearms to lift these big four-wheelers as he makes the championship in the quad racer. Gary Denton, followed by Greg Clark, Ron Baker, and Brian Fine.
Today's Framoto Light performance tip is on temperature and humidity and its effect on tuning of the engine.
Temperature, humidity, and altitude have a major effect on tuning. A hot day, moist day, or high altitude make the bike too rich. Cold day, dry air, and low altitude make the bike lean. As an example, the difference between 90% humidity and 30% humidity can make a difference as much as 2 jet sizes. Remember, don't trust the seat of your pants. Tune like the pro and let your spark plug tell you what your engine is doing.
We'll get back to more 125cc racing in just a moment. But first, let's see some of the action in the final laps of the 250cc class.
4 laps to go. O'Mara trying to hang on to win the Rose Bowl Supercross. Ward and Glover battling second and third for the overall. And Ricky Johnson, a key man, trying to help Glover, his teammate.
If he can stay in front of Johnny and Jeff, he can kind of hold back the race, and Brock can move up right behind Ward. And I think that's what's happening right now. Ward's kind of getting a little bit panicky, trying to get by the lap riders and Ricky Johnson. So the race is going to be really tight between the top three guys.
There's nothing after this. There they go. It's Ward. They're coming into that real rugged set of whoop-de-doos. David, what's going on at this late date?
Well, according to my stopwatch, the first three leaders are within 3 seconds of one another. It is an incredible battle, especially for a Supercross of this magnitude.
Now, Ward and Glover have a lap man between them. That's got to help Ward.
They just got by him just now, so that's all right. They're in the clear.
There's Ricky Johnson.
He's not going to let Johnny O'Mara. He moved over for him.
O'Mara's not his main concern, though.
No, it's Ward for Brock Glover for the overall championship.
Boy, they are tightening up. There is O'Mara. There comes Ward. Here comes Glover. This is what everybody's been wanting. 2 laps to go. What a finish we're going to have.
This is incredible. If Brock can get by Ward, he'll win the championship. The first time ever for Yamaha in the past, I think, 3 years now.
There's a lap man. As Ward takes a corner, O'Mara still wants to hang on. He wants the Rose Bowl championship. Ward's got to hang on. Stay ahead of Glover. Second and third, what a battle. Osho's not going as high now with just a lap and a half to go.
He seems to be slowing down a little bit. Ward's really trying hard, and so is Glover. It's an incredible race.
1, 2, and 3. There's Osho. O'Mara, he's got the lead. He can win the Rose Bowl championship. 1 lap to go. Here comes Ward. Here comes Glover. Brock Glover must pass Ward. Ford's got to pass too in order to win the overall championship. Now there's some lap people getting in O'Mara's way. There's Ward. Glover right on him. There they come down the table. On the bit of a straightaway. Glover seems to be losing a little ground on Ward. What a perfect shot you have there. That's O'Mara coming into the rockers. These are tough rockers, his last set. Ward right behind him on the corner. O'Mara blocks him. He won't shoot past him. Here's Glover. I don't know if Glover has enough time. He's opening it up full throttle. Here they come up the hill. Watch the checker. Here it comes. It's O'Mara and Ward, the overall champ. Glover comes in third. Ward beats him out for the 1985 250 Supercross. And what an outstanding race. It wasn't the track that determined it. It was the riders themselves. There's Glover. What courage. What courage with a broken wrist. There's Ward. He maintained his pace. He even went after O'Mara the whole race. He wanted to come in first, but he won the overall. This is the starting lineup for the 125cc championship final. These are the people who did such an outstanding job in the qualifying rounds to make it this far. The fans are all pumped up for this action, and you can be sure the racers are very intent on getting an outstanding start. They're lining up at the starting gate. 10 laps.
This is it.
All the marbles.
You can feel the tension. These are mainly youngsters. These kids aren't old enough to drink in most states. They're not old enough to do a lot of things. Some of them can't even vote yet as they start. They're between 16 and 20 years old. The favorite, Larry Brooks, is in his early 20s. And here they go through the start breaker, and it's broken about five people. But they get up, nobody injured. They're just in the back.
They're going to have a lot of trouble catching up, though. This is a big field, and these are the best at the 125cc. This track is rugged. This is one of the toughest Supercross tracks ever designed. And they've been doing it since 1972. Good look at the drop off the big mountain. There go the 125ers, flying over. You saw a rooster tail right in front of our camera. Brooks on top. The 125cc championships here from the Rose Bowl. Brooks goes against people with a little more experience. He started late, but he doesn't worry about it. He just thinks, what do I do to increase my speed? These people are not taking the double jumps two at a time yet. Brooks flying across the first hoop-de-doos.
In second place now, Steve Smits, number 29.
He's got to fend off the people behind him as Brooks goes over the triple jump three at a time. And now he's coming up the mountain and down the backside of the drop. Dave Stanfield's on the field. What do you see at that location?
I see a lot of dirt flying, and I'll tell you, the track is starting to deteriorate. These 125s are really tearing it up. They are so quick and agile, and the crowd is pumping them up even more to go faster and faster.
We have a man down at the front side of the whoop-de-doos. It's Kurt Hendrickson, and boy, he took a beating. I don't know if he was hit or not. It happened so fast next to the bale. They're attending him right now. They've got EMS people there. There you see him on the track. And yes, he was run over before he could get off the track. Oh, my. They look like they're rolling him onto the gurney or the stretcher first. Danny Laporte, you were recovering from a broken leg.
Yeah.
And you know how dangerous this can be. When you see that and you're racing and you go by and see a man being put on the stretcher, what goes through the rider's mind?
Well, I don't think very much. When it happens so fast, they don't really... Really, it doesn't hurt. It's not like it happens so quick. It just happens. There's nothing they can do about it.
Okay, but now they are passing. They see a man down. Does it wear in the back of their minds that they've got to be more cautious, or they can't let that happen to their own mind?
No, I don't think so. The top racers that I know, I don't think it's ever bothered them at all.
Dave Stanfield has a medical report for it.
Well, right now they are just trying to treat him, take a look at him. They don't want to move him too quick, and they just want him out of the way so other riders don't hit him.
However, these riders are well protected as far as their gear is concerned for this very exciting and, yes, dangerous sport. Prior to tonight's race, Dave Stanfield prepared a special feature on their safety equipment.
You'd be surprised to find out that injuries in this wild sport are pretty uncommon for two reasons. First of all, athletes like Bobby Moore here, top 125cc rider, is in peak physical condition. Second of all, it's the safety equipment he wears. Down at the bottom, these boots are tough. His shins, ankles, toes, totally protected. There's plastic here to protect his knees. Coming up to full motocross gloves, he's got a belt here that gives him support, rock guard, shoulder pads here, helmet, full face, and his goggles. They even have roll-offs here, so when they get dirty, he can change his lens and has clear vision instantly.
No need to change the lenses on Larry Brooks' goggles. He has taken full command of this championship race. Look how smoothly he goes over the whoop-de-doos to his only chance for some speed. On the straightaway, they go over 50 miles an hour. Eddie Hicks has moved into fourth place. Dave Stanfield, what's up down there?
It looks like Larry Brooks is pulling away easily. He's got an 8-second lead. He's totally under control. He's not being pressured at all. Larry Brooks with a commanding lead here, and it looks like he's going to win this thing if he doesn't make a mistake.
And there's Brooks, the leader. Brooks staying in the lines,
taking the jumps and taking the corners beautifully.
Yeah, he's really smooth. He's got really good throttle control. When he comes out of the corner, he accelerates real smooth. That's why he slides the bike to the corners like he does. He takes a little bit tighter lines than some of the other riders.
And somebody you saw on the back of your screen spun out on that number two corner, so the caution goes up. That number two corner is treacherous. As you can, by looking at it, John Ortner is the man there. He's okay, he just gotta get back on. That was a tight, very tight corner take.
That's
by
right, Steve.
Brooks, and one lap to go. The white flag is out. Brooks looks like he's got his adrenaline pumping now as he wants to wrap this baby up, going through the whoop-de-doo.
Steve, it looks like he wants to lap everybody out there, but he's only got one more lap to go, so, oh, he almost went off the course there. But he's all right now.
Almost high-sided, but maintained control as we see the leader with one lap to go.
He's getting a lap sign to take it easy and kind of slow down because he's on the last lap.
What a good look we have there at the leader, Larry Brooks, in the 125cc championship. There's how spread out this whole thing has gotten. It's hard to believe they were so crunched early in the first lap.
It's kind of hard to tell who's in what position when they start lapping each other.
What a great look at Brooks. Get ready for the checker. And they're coming out with the checker for Larry Brooks. And he won it handily. He was up to 8, maybe 10 seconds on his lead. Over these racers who are going to fight for second and third. Who gets over? It looks like Dean Madsen and possibly Eddie Hicks rounding out the top three in this 125cc championship. There are your unofficial results. This was an outstanding race by Larry Brooks.
All right, Larry.
And Dave Stanfield's got the happy winner.
Larry, you made it look a little too easy.
Oh, it wasn't that easy. I had a few guys on my butt for a while there, but then I started pulling away at the end.
Okay, the start. Was that the hard part?
Like I said before, the start's the hardest part, and I got it again. I'm really happy right now.
Track was okay, wasn't it?
Yeah, it got rutted out, nice and rough, the way I like it.
Why were you pulling out? Why were you pushing us so hard?
Win big. Make people know who's the best.
All right, congratulations.
Thanks a lot.
Dave, I want to ask him real quickly.
One question. He doesn't
look like he's even sweating. It looks like he's just come out of the shower.
He's not. Well, he's got a little sweat over his eye. Are you tired?
No, not really. These indoor night races don't even get me tired. I train hard during the week and run in the heat, so come to night racing, it's really easy.
All right, congratulations.
Thanks.
Big win.
Thank you.
There's our champion, Larry Brooks, in the 125cc championship from the Rose Bowl. Stay with us. We'll be right back. And these are the official results for tonight's race. Larry Brooks, the big winner. Dean Madsen second. Eddie Hicks came in third. Overall for the season, Bobby Moore has now overtaken Mike Healy. And Bobby Moore is the seasonal point standing champion. And there you see a portion of the throng that was on here tonight to be entertained by some very exciting Supercross action. The man who gave most of the excitement was our winner, Larry Brooks. Right now, let's go down to the ceremony room where Steve LaValle of Fram Autolite is going to make a special presentation.
Congratulations, Larry. I'd like to present you with this trophy from Fram Filters and Autolite Sparkle.
Okay, thank you.
A very happy Larry Brooks on receiving his trophy tonight, and a very well-deserved victory. Along with Danny Laporte and Dave Stanfield, I'm Steve Grad. We hope you've enjoyed it from the Rose Bowl. We've enjoyed bringing it to you.
This has been a 1985 Moto Video presentation.